just don't grab the mic.
Well, good morning, and welcome to St. Anderson Stephen's Presbyterian Church. It's slightly different this morning because during this week we installed a new sanctuary computer and a new camera up the back. So poor Owen right now, everybody just be on your knees praying for him because he is controlling everything this morning, absolutely everything. And so he's been on a steep learning curve, but it's going well. And we're just so blessed to have you still volunteering and helping every Sunday. It's great to be together, even though we're not together. It's great that we are joining with you. You're joining with us in your worship spaces as we gather for worship this morning. Just a couple of quick announcements before we get going. Remember, this is a good opportunity for you to check now that your microphone is muted and that your video is turned off. Do you remember we said last week, it's wonderful that we're together, but we don't really need to see you watching or eating your cornflakes during the first 10 or 15 minutes of the service. So please mute your mics, turn off your videos, and as you get up to do that, make sure that you have some bread and fruit of the vine ready this morning, because we're gonna partake in communion the last third of our service this morning. We're going to share communion together, so make sure you get some bread and grape juice or whatever, black coffee, whatever might be your want this morning as we plan for communion together. Don't forget that this Wednesday night we're going to meet again for Let's Get Together. We did the first of those this past Wednesday evening. It was fun to get together with about a dozen people. Just have a bit of a conversation about what's going on in our lives right now and things like that. And so we'd love to actually have a conversation. It's just a bit of fun, a bit of community. And I know that a lot of people are just zoomed out because there's so many online meetings right now. But if you would like to get together for about 45, 50 minutes on a Wednesday evening, 7 o'clock, Let's Get Together. Well, it's fabulous to be together this morning, even if we're not physically together. We are together virtually to worship together. And as a symbol of that, I'm going to invite you now to light your candles in your spaces of worship as we make that active symbolic movement that the light of the world is with us wherever we be. Jesus is in our midst. We are in his presence right now. So let's join together in worship as we light our candles. And to lead us into worship this morning, I'm going to invite Pastor Daniel to come forward this morning.
Good morning. So I'm going to share a reading with you from the Gospel of John, chapter 17, verse 20 to 26. Jesus prays and says, "My prayer is not for them alone. I pray also for those who will believe in me through their message, that all of them may be one. Father, just as you are in me and I am in you, may they also be in us, so that the world might believe that you have sent me. I have given them the glory that you gave me, that they might be one as we are one, I in them and you in me, so that they may be brought to complete unity. Then the world will know that you sent me, and I have loved them, even as you have loved me. Father, I want those you have given me to be with me where I am, and to see my glory, the glory you have given me because you loved me before the creation of the world. Righteous Father, though the world does not know, I know you, and they know that you have sent me. I have made you known to them, and will continue to make you known, in order that the love you have for me may be in them, and that I myself may be in them. The word of the Lord. So Jesus prays for us to be one, and today it's difficult times to do that, but think about this. Jesus said, I am going away, but I'm going to leave someone behind with you, the Holy Spirit. So remember, it's okay to, you know, thank technology because we are getting together, but we are one not because of technology. We are one because we have the Holy Spirit in you, in us, in your home today. And the same Spirit is uniting us, getting us to be one community, one people, one family of faith, under one God and one faith. So think about this. The same Spirit is with us today, in every home, in every heart. Thanks to that Spirit is that we are one in this morning. So let's pray. Dear God, thank you for this day. Thank you because your Holy Spirit allows us to be together and worship you, even though we are physically not together. You are with us. You are in us, in every family, in every home, in every heart. Loving God, we want to worship you today because you are our God and we are your people. In these difficult times today, we acknowledge that you are God over the whole world and over everything that is going on today. Faithful God, we come to you today because only in you we find eternal life and living hope. Speak to us today. Many of us are facing stress and difficulties and challenges because of this pandemic. So we need to hear your words of life, your words of hope. And we acknowledge, as Peter did in the Gospel of John, to whom shall we go? Only you have words of eternal life. So we come to you this morning to worship you, to get together as a one family of faith, and to hear from you. Holy Spirit, as we worship today, let us remember that you are in us, in every person, in every home today, making your people one, one people with one God, one faith. Thank you, Lord, because of your sacrifice that we will remember today in Holy Communion. We know that we are one in you. Although we are away from each other, we are united in your Spirit, your Holy Spirit. So as we gather today in one spirit and in one heart, give us the joy of your presence. Even in these difficult times of isolation, let us know that you are with us, that this family is still together, holding each other in prayer, in love, in your love. Let us feel your presence and love among us. Let your people know that we are not alone, that we have each other still, and you are with us. Let us know that we have a family of faith that holds us as well, to pray together, to think of each other, and to support every person in this church. So we pray that you keep your church united in hope and in love in this time. Let your Holy Spirit visit us this morning and let us know this truth, that you are with us. So now we pray as you taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever. Amen.
Thanks, Daniel. So, I've got a quick question for everybody sitting in their worship spaces, right? You actually now have to make a physical movement. I want you to raise your hand if you are a child of God. Owen's busy raising his hand to try and change the camera angle. So that's awesome. So hopefully everybody raised their hands, right? And I was thinking about this week because some of you have noticed on the Zoom, on the worship service these past couple of weeks, that I put a banner on the lectern that says, Lord, reign in us. That we are all children of God, and that it's the Lord that is actually reigning in us right now, not this pandemic. As frustrating as everything is right now with what is going on in the world, in our society, it's the Lord that reigns in us. So I think we're all needing something to kind of lift us a little bit. So I have a gift for you this morning. It's a blessing and it's a challenge. So right now, Owen is going to share something with you. It's about 2.5 minutes long. And I especially want all the kids at home to pay particularly attention to this. But I remember I asked who was a child of God. So if you're a child of God, I want you to pay particular attention to this. And then I will tell you why after you watch it. This is a blessing and a challenge. Over to Owen. Okay, so hopefully you watched that, and that was actually quite good fun. So that's a blessing. It's a Rand Co Kids song called King of Me. So I've got a challenge for you. For every family that is watching right now, all the kids, all children of God, here's your challenge. During this coming week, in the newsletter that I will send out and also on the website, the link to that song is going to be advertised. I want you to come up with a dance or actions to that song.
Nice.
Right? So all the parents are going to be driven crazy listening to this song every day for the next 7 days. I want you to come up with your own actions, your own dance for that song, and you're going to video yourself doing them as a family, not just the kids, everybody, as many videos as we can possibly get, and you're going to send the videos to Pastor Daniel. And after next weekend, I'm not throwing this at him, he knows this is coming, he's going to splice the whole lot together. And in 2 weeks' time, we're going to re-listen to that song with all of us doing the actions and the dance to, okay? So you're going to play King of Me this week, learn the song, create your own actions and dance moves to it, record yourself as a family doing it, and send them to Pastor Daniel, and he's going to splice the whole thing together. It's a blessing, and it's also a challenge, and I hope we have a lot of fun. In the newsletter that's coming out hopefully tomorrow, I actually say, be creative, be energetic, but please be careful, right? We don't want any injuries as you try to do that with giants and lions and the creatures of the sea. So enjoy that. Over Lent, we did a sermon series here called The Story We Find Ourselves In. And hopefully, going through that story in 7 weeks, we discovered that the central theme, really through that story, is the relationship that God has with his creation, with his people, you and I. That all of those relationships have been badly corrupted. And so God is working to actually redeem, reconcile all of creation and all of those relationships. The one aspect of the story that we left out was the church. The part of the story that comes between Christ and consummation. I guess I should have done that the other way around in terms of timeline for you guys. Christ and consummation. We are in that space in between. What does it look like for us to be part of that story in the midst of this ongoing redemption of our relationships? Over the next 4 weeks, we're going to look at 4 different New Testament words that describe God's people, the church. Today we begin with fellowship, then we're going to look at service, we're going to look at the proclamation, proclaiming that Jesus is Lord of our lives, that God really does reign in us, and then we will finish with the word witness on Ascension Sunday, that we are witnesses to the risen Lord Jesus. What does it look like for us to be a church that is part of a story that should be bringing all of creation back under God, for God to really be Lord of all? As we begin that series today, we're going to begin it with listening to another piece of music by the same band, a piece of music that's been near and dear to my heart, that I hope will be a prayer of blessing, a prayer of hope for us as a church, so that over these next 4 weeks, that our Lord would build his church in us, and that we would be a church on fire for the Lord Jesus. So I would invite you, if you're in your homes right now, to stamp your feet, clap your hands, sing along to this wonderful song that's called Build Your Kingdom Here.
sharing up there because I think the shares stopped. It's not up the screen now, it's that advanced on the door.
Be share behind.
Is it?
Yeah.
Well, good morning, SaaS family. Oh, I'm coming through on two microphones. Would you like me to turn off?
Nope, got it covered.
Got it covered. That's a great place to begin, and that is with a word of appreciation and gratitude. First of all, to Pastor Martin for leading this church through a time of just extreme adaptive leadership. And Pastor Daniel as well, and Owen, is working like crazy back there. I wish you could all see the behind the scenes, but if you've ever seen the movie Anchorman, you'll have a sense of what's going on in the sanctuary. It's awesome to see all that's taking place here, and it's great to be with you in your homes as we begin this new sermon series on the church. And as Pastor Martin mentioned, today we're looking at the theme of fellowship. And they've been bold, not even the CTAs at the seminary let me advance my own slides, but I'm going to try. So Owen, will I be able to see those up at the front?
You should be able to now.
This is an exciting moment for all of us, not only at home. Look at that. Okay, and so I will boldly move it forward one, and magically the sermon slide should appear.
Go ahead. Again.
Again? There we are. Fantastic. So great to be able to share some reflections today with you on the theme of fellowship. Let's begin with a brief word of prayer. God, this day finds us in many different places. Normally on a Sunday, on your Sabbath, we are the church gathered in one place. And once benediction is pronounced, we are the church scattered.
We are sent out as witnesses into the world to live our everyday, ordinary lives, discerning the presence of the risen Christ and naming his redeeming work. And yet, in this extended time of being scattered, we thank you for the way in which you are gathering us now. We thank you for the fellowship that is taking place online, through phone calls and letters and texts, for all the ways that we are experiencing communion with you. And so as we turn to your word today, we ask that your Holy Spirit would meet us, as Pastor Daniel prayed, wherever we are today, in our homes or listening later online. We offer up this prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. So I've entitled today's reflection, "What's the Fuss About Fellowship?" And I was thinking how every community has its own language. Owen, I'm trying my best here. It's not working for me. Oh, there we go. Fantastic. Now, did I do that or did you do that?
I don't know.
Okay, this is so exciting. So every community has its own language and customs. Think with me, you can fill in your own blanks, but I was thinking about Pastor Martin's favorite coffee shop is Starbucks. And when you think about it, Starbucks has its own language, right? There's venti and grande. You can't order a large coffee at Starbucks. They'll look at you kind of funny. Tim Hortons, if you're more of a Tim Hortons person, there's the double-double, right? And Timbits. Accounting, if that's your world, you have gross margins. And fruit and tree doctrines, had to look that one up. And medicine has horripilation. Do you know what that is, Daniel? That's goosebumps. And then I mentioned this earlier, and our pastor blushed a little bit. Rhinorrhea. Pastor Martin, do you know what rhinorrhea is?
You're going to tell me if I can.
It's a runny nose.
Whoa.
Who knew? Rhinorrhea. It's true. And so there's every kind of community has its own language. And so too with the church. Isn't that a sparkling looking picture there? So too in the church, we have curious words that have developed over time. Just think about it. Narthex, that's a strange word. Homologate, odd, but Presbyterians use it all the time. Soteriology. And we also have this word, fellowship. I have to confess, as I was sitting this week writing the sermon, I thought, am I honest about the word fellowship? And I thought, yeah, okay, I'll be honest. I've never been a big fan of the word fellowship. It always feels a little fussy to me, fellowship. Something like the nice sitting room in my grandma's house with crocheted things and breakables, a space that we were never allowed to go into and play as a child, fellowship. So let's think together this morning about what is the fuss about fellowship. Now, confession, I've used fellowship tons as a pastor. Please join us for coffee in the fellowship hall, right? Or the men's group will meet Wednesday morning for conversation and fellowship. Too often I fear that we hear the word fellowship and we simply imagine a friendly or a social engagement. But when we talk about fellowship in the church, we're drawing on the Greek word koinonia, which means much more than a simple social gathering. It means an intimate, spiritual connection with others. It means communion, which is why Pastor Martin has decided to celebrate communion together as we look at this theme of fellowship, shared life together. Now, that may sound lovely, but for those of us who have been cooped up with others for over a month now, due to COVID-19, I suspect the rose is long off the bloom when it comes to intense and intentional shared life together. I know in our house, just staying sane is counted as a daily gain. I'm sure in a godlier house like Daniel's, that's not a problem. But there are some of us for whom shared life together is sounding like something we need a break from at this moment. There is a temptation to believe that in the early church, fellowship was easy. It was natural. They shared everything in common, etc., etc. You know, we go to texts like Acts 2 or Acts 4, and it becomes the poster child for what our shared life together should be like, having everything in common. I may need Owen to advance that slide. Good man. Thank you very much indeed. Let's have a look at this text. All the believers were one in heart and mind. No one claimed that any of their possessions was their own, but they shared everything they had. With great power, the apostles continued to testify to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus. And God's grace was so powerfully at work in all of them that there were no needy persons among them. For from time to time, those who owned land or houses sold them, brought the money from the sales, and put it at the apostles' feet. And it was distributed to anyone who had need. Joseph, a Levite from Cyprus, whom the apostles called Barnabas, which means son of encouragement, sold a field he owned and brought the money and lay it at the apostles' feet. I think we'll go one more slide, please, Owen. But be warned, friends, we may be redeemed sinners by the blood of Christ, but we are still sinners nonetheless, reflecting the total human depravity of our fallen nature. For from this ideal scene in Acts 4, we turn the page and we meet Ananias and Sapphira. They too, like Barnabas, sold land and came to make a donation and pick up their Canada Revenue Tax receipt from the church treasurer. And Peter is moderating the session meeting of First Reformed Church Jerusalem in the book of Acts, and somehow knows that while Ananias is making a big deal of donating the land to the church, he's secretly holding back some of the profit for himself. Uh-oh. Upon being confronted by Peter, Ananias falls down dead. A couple of elders carry him out back and bury him. I'm not making this up. It's Acts 5:6. You can check it out later. 3 hours later, his wife Sapphira drops by the church, and the whole scene repeats again. Accusation, denial, death. Yikes. Sapphira is taken out back and buried. Can you imagine? The board of managers declines to make a report that night in light of the incidents, and moderator Peter entertains a motion to adjourn. I would call that the worst session meeting ever. Next slide, please. Dietrich Bonhoeffer cautioned people from imagining a Christian life together, a Christian community so perfect that they were bound to be disappointed in his work pictured here, a classic work, Life Together. Listen to his words. He writes bluntly, "He who loves his dream of a community more than the Christian community itself becomes a destroyer of the latter, even though his personal intentions may be ever so honest and earnest and sacrificial." Noting that Christian community consists solely in what Christ has done for us, he writes, "Christian fellowship is not an ideal which we must realize. It is rather a reality created by God in Christ in which we may participate." Now, the church is not an ideal place. The church is a place where people can get hurt. As a professor, when I hear students complain about the church, I tell them to take a number and get in line. We all have our scars from being in church. My friend Rob Fennell, who I grew up with in Winnipeg and is now dean of the Atlantic School of Theology, has a line that he's used for years. "The blessing of the church is that everyone is welcome. And the curse of the church is that everyone is welcome." And yet, Christian life is meant to be shared with others. Just as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit exist in mutual self-giving love, our life is meant to be lived with others in communion. No solitary Christians allowed. Just me and Jesus on the golf course Sunday mornings does not equal church. For as lovely as it sounds to be out on the golf course right now. Next slide. It reminds me of the story of a pastor who went to visit a lapsed member of the church. No words were exchanged. A roaring coal fire was going in the man's house. The pastor came in and he took tongs and he took a red hot coal out of the fireplace, held it for a moment, and lay it on the hearth. Sat down in the chair beside the man, and the two of them sat and watched that lone coal go from red hot to black to gray. The pastor stood up and left, his message and point being received. Next slide, everyone. Instead of having an idealized version of community in our minds, it's helpful to search God's word for examples of how our Christian ancestors struggled to hold together during challenging times. The letters of John that we're focusing on today bear evidence of a Christian minority, at times under persecution, knitting together a common life that gave God glory. Now, we don't often hear from John's letters in church. Both Martin Luther and John Calvin offered commentaries on the first letter, but not the second or the third. Luther paid it high praise, saying, "This is an outstanding epistle. It can buoy up afflicted hearts. Furthermore, it has John's style and manner of expression so beautifully and gently does it picture Christ to us." The second letter of John that we'll be referring to in a few moments is not even on the Revised Common Lectionary. If people attend a church where they only hear lectionary readings their whole lives, they would never hear the text we're looking at today preached on. While the authorship of the letter has been disputed, it has generally been attributed to the Apostle John, brother of James, fisherman of the Galilee. Dionysius, Bishop of Alexandria, back in the 3rd century, was already noting the consistency in writing style between the Gospel of John and the letters of John, and this was reaffirmed down through the years by folks like Luther, Calvin, and Wesley. Who these letters are written to is a little bit vague, maybe Ephesus in Asia Minor, close to Patmos, where John was exiled. Today we're zeroing in on this short little letter. It's even calling it a letter is a bit of a stretch. Maybe a text message would be better, of 2 John. It is short enough to fit on a napkin. 2 John gives us a way of approaching this notion of fellowship, shared life together. It begins beautifully. We'll see that on this slide here that Owen has for us. It begins, "To the lady chosen by God and to her children, who I love in truth, and not I only, but also all who know the truth, because of the truth which lives in us and will be with us forever, grace, mercy, peace from God the Father and from Jesus Christ, the Father's Son, will be with us in truth and love. It has given me great joy to find some of your children walking in the truth, just as the Father commanded us. And now, dear lady, I am not writing you a new commandment, but one we have had from the beginning. I ask that we love one another, and this is love, that we walk in obedience to his commandments. As you have heard from the beginning, his command is that you walk in love." Now, you may ask, who's involved in this correspondence? It's a good question. At first glance, this sounds a little bit like your SAS elder writing to a family in the church to tell them that the Olive Press newsletter is ready to go. But look closer. Most scholars acknowledge that what we have here is actually code language from an early church leader, John in this case, to another distant church community. Just like in the New Testament, when you hear the language of Babylon, it doesn't mean Babylon, it's code language for Rome and the empire. Here the letter keeps things anonymous, perhaps because they were in a wave of persecution and didn't want these letters to fall into the wrong hands. So if the elder is code language for the Apostle John, the lady and her children becomes the congregation and its members of an unspecified New Testament church. The elder commends the members for walking in the truth as the Father commanded us. And here we have an echo of John's gospel. Remember that beautiful Maundy Thursday service that Pastor Martin led us through as a SAS community? I think it was the last time, actually, we celebrated communion together. And we noted that Maundy is Latin for commandment. Let's have a look at this next slide, Owen. Thank you.
Yours works now.
It works now. Hooray. John 13, "A new commandment I give you, love one another. As I have loved you, so you must love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you love one another." So that's John's gospel. Now listen to the echo in the letter. "And now, dear lady, I am not writing you a new commandment, but one we have had from the beginning, I ask that we love one another. To be clear, this love is not eros, romantic love, the kind that you need to enter a special code on your Netflix account to watch, or philia, friendship bond, or storge, empathy bond, but agape, unconditional love that we have received from Jesus in empty cross and empty tomb. This is the love that the Christian fellowship is called to share in order to walk worthily as disciples of Jesus. But again, before we fall into that retreat to Acts 2, the early church was perfect and called for a group hug. By the way, it's one of the nice side effects of COVID-19, no more group hugs. That's especially encouraging. 2 John continues with this next piece, not all is well. Writes, I say this because many deceivers who do not acknowledge Jesus Christ as coming in the flesh have gone out into the world. Any such person is the deceiver and the Antichrist. Watch out that you do not lose what we have worked for, but that you may be rewarded fully. Anyone who runs ahead and does not continue in the teaching of Christ does not have God. Whoever continues in the teaching has both Father and Son. If anyone comes to you and does not bring this teaching, do not take them into your house or welcome them. Anyone who welcomes them shares in their wicked work. Well, now we've got trouble in paradise, apparently. If you read through the first letter of John, you encounter a church fight, a split. And here in the second letter, to a totally different community, we read advice given to avoid such a rupture in church fellowship. That was a painful internal church fight, but here in 2 John, it's more of a warning of who you let in the door. It appears there were traveling missionaries who were operating out of a heretical position known as docetism, denying that God actually came in the flesh in Jesus Christ. And there's a danger of contamination by association, according to the elder. Now, some have critiqued this passage as like a terrible example of Christian shunning. However, in many ways, it feels more like an exercise in social distancing from the virus of heresy. I interpret this as the elder trying to encourage the community to keep focused on the crucified and risen Christ in their midst, that being the body of Christ is central and key. A community built on the commandment of love, a community longing for an incarnational set of relationships. I think we can relate to this. Are we not longing for incarnation these days in COVID-19 when we might see with our own eyes and touch with our own hands those that we love, reminding us that God indeed came in Jesus Christ, flesh and blood, and moved into the neighborhood? We're longing for incarnation, whether this day finds you alone at home or with your loved ones. There's still that sense of not being able to connect in the way that we want to. And that urge to connect is good, and it's godly, because we've been made for relationship with God and with one another. And our relationships matter. There's a quote from Rowan Williams, former Archbishop of Canterbury, where he says, the life of the Christian community has as its rationale, if not invariably its practical reality, the task of teaching us to so order our relationships that human beings may see themselves as desired, as the occasion of joy. Do you know that's what you are to us here at SAS? You are desired, each and every person, the occasion of joy. Stefan Passa, a colleague of mine in Amsterdam, writes, that viewed through the lens of Koinonia theology, the mission of the triune God may be defined as restoration of his fallen creation in his image. Or, more briefly, God's mission is about the restoration and renewal of relationships. The struggle is that we live in a world that Zygmunt Bauman called liquid modernity, in which he aptly named the tension between our desire for autonomy and community. That at least prior to COVID-19, those were really in tension, right? I want to belong. I want community, but on my own schedule. And of course, as we discussed This koinonia is not simply a social time. It's the body of Christ gathered in fellowship, and it's for a purpose, the equipping of the saints for ministry. In this time of social isolation, how has your previous equipping in the fellowship of SAS helped you stay close to the Lord and be a witness to the gospel where you live? What's your growing edge these days of discipleship? And how might this church fellowship help come along and equip you better for the ministry that you have through your baptism, wherever God has placed you this day? Pastor Martin mentioned that the end of the sermon series is witness. And indeed, there is such a deep connection between koinonia and witness. Daryl Guter speaks in terms of witness in three ways. Being witness, just who we are, the character that God has given us is a witness. Doing witnesses are the actions we perform. And saying witness is the words that we choose to bless others. All of that we learn through our time in Christian fellowship. So in this time of being together and apart, how are you embodying the fullness of life we have been given in Jesus? How are you acting in grace-filled, socially distant ways, maybe online, to demonstrate that you are walking worthily and fulfilling the commandment to love one another? How are you putting the joy of the gospel into words so that in a fearful and anxious time, you're communicating the love of God and participating in his ongoing healing of the nations? Our time together will come again. This may not be an ideal time for fellowship, and yet the early church often was at a distance, writing letters back and forth when they could not meet in person. And this day we give God thanks for technology that links our fellowship, our communion, and we look forward to the days to come when we meet again in person. Or, as the elder said it best at the closing of his letter, "I have much to write to you, but I do not want to use paper and ink. Instead, I hope to visit with you and talk with you face to face so that our joy may be complete." In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Thank you, Ross, for sharing with us this morning on fellowship. As we are now coming to share in the Lord's Supper together, first let me apologize to Ross for the technical issues that were happening at the beginning of his sermon, which he was unaware of, or he probably was, because there was myself, Pastor Daniel, and Owen frantically communicating at the back. And I think, unfortunately, we have the same, it's really, really difficult that when we have whatever 80, 90 connections on, all it takes is for one connection to have their mic unmuted and we get an echo coming through. And so Ross, you were preaching in stereo this morning,
yes,
in a number of houses, and then we got it muted. So I think they lost the first couple of minutes, but we got it back, and so that's why we didn't stop you and say, let's do a reboot. So apologies to Ross for us losing the first couple of minutes. But they got to see you the whole time. But Ross, how has this, and we kind of go off script a little bit, how has this pandemic changed your daily life?
Yeah, so it's been a crazy time. In prayer before worship, I was noting there are people, and if this is you at home, I just say bless you. I see people posting things like, I've never had so much free time, and I've learned 3 foreign languages. And I just think, wow, like, I have never been busier. It's been totally insane. It's been busy at the college in good ways. It's been really busy at home, and the adjustment to having all of us under the same roof, our home Wi-Fi is sagging with up to 4 Zoom calls at the same time. And yet it has been a deliberate interruption of scheduling, and so I've been trying my best to look for where God is in the midst of that and what God is.
So say more about that, because that's actually what I've been asking people over the past few weeks.
Yeah, where Jamie was last week. I saw Jamie.
Yeah, so I spoke to you a few days ago on the phone, and you happened to drop in in the midst that you're on your way to like Zoom call 4 of 7 yeah. for that day. So yeah. your life right now is spent hugely online with your class. Classes and also just in meetings and boards and all the rest of it. But where do you see God in all of this, Ross?
Yeah, I mean, there's that sense in which I think it's shifting our understanding of incarnation. I think that incarnation has meant for a lot of us physical connection. And yet I still find it so encouraging to receive texts from people, to talk on the phone, to recognize there are different ways of being connected. And for both of us, with mums who normally live at a significant geographic distance, Northern Ireland and Manitoba, I mean, I think some of us who have family, and lots of folks from the SAS community have families scattered all over the world, we've always been doing this to a certain degree, like trying to be connected with someone at a great geographic distance. I think that the challenging part has been when we're used to being with people right here and not being able to see that. But I do see God at work in the way in which people are caring for each other. I see it in my townhouse complex where I live in North Van, neighbors going out of their way to check in on each other. I certainly see it in the heroic work of our healthcare workers and other frontline workers. So I think God is showing up in all kinds of ways. But I also find that I have rear view mirror theology, that I often will discern God's presence most looking back. And so I'm curious about when this has passed and when we look back on the lessons that we've learned from this time.
Yeah, so again, thank you for sharing this morning on the theme of fellowship and this, you know, focusing on 2 John, this commandment to love one another. And, you know, we are trying our best. We're trying to love each other by doing the services as best we can, and we get technical glitches, but we've got such a loving community. They all text immediately to say, it's not working.
Yes. But maybe it shows their love, because otherwise they could have just said,
So that we want to hear more. Tell them to start over. So a loving community. But here we gather around tables, and I vision all of these participants on our call this morning, wherever it may be, in their living rooms or in around a kitchen table, and they're gathered around some small screen. Some have been very technical and they've airdropped the service onto their televisions, and they've got a roaring fire going, you know. But hopefully in each of our spaces, right now we can visibly see a candle that is that symbol that Jesus is in our midst. And we also have some bread and some fruit of the vine, symbols that Jesus is with us, and his love is very evident in what we actually see, that he has given his life for us. So we are going to gather around the table right now. There are a number of people in the SAS community that are going to participate now over the next 5 minutes or so in a little liturgy to lead us to the communion table. So just 2 quick things. Number 1, please, everybody, just double check that your mics are muted right now before we go any further, because the people that are involved, then I'm relying on you to unmute yourselves as you follow along in your script so that we can hear and possibly see you. So for those of you who are on your computers right now, this would be a good time to make sure that you've got it on speaker view and not gallery view. Speaker view will allow you to actually see the people that are going to be sharing and speaking with us as we draw to our Lord's table. So again, check that your microphones are muted. And for those of you who are going to be speaking, I'm relying on you to actually unmute at the appropriate time, because I have no means of actually double checking on that. I'm relying on Owen to kind of relay the sound so that we hear what's going on. But as we gather, let's take a moment just in silent reflection on what Ross has shared with us this morning, what it means to us to gather around these incredible elements of bread and wine. Let's share together. Brothers and sisters in the Lord Jesus Christ, this meal that we are about to celebrate together in all of our worship spaces is a feast of remembrance, a feast of communion, a feast of hope.
We come in remembrance that our Lord Jesus, being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness. And being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross.
By his death, resurrection, and ascension, Jesus established a new and eternal covenant of grace and reconciliation, that all who believe in him might be called sons and daughters of God, and never be forsaken by him.
So I'm going to invite all of us to stand wherever we are in our worship spaces as we declare our faith together in the words of the Apostles' Creed that will be on the screen behind me, and we're going to zoom in on that screen, I think, so that we can share it together. Let's declare our faith together in these incredible words of faith. We believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there, he will come to judge the living and the dead. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated in your worship spaces. Well, we need to hear what the Zoom meeting's actually doing. You need to unmute the computer channel on the soundboard. Is the sound channel on the soundboard that has the computer volume, is that playing through the system?
Blessing, he comes to us as the vine, in whom we must abide together if we are to bear fruit. We come to share in the taking of these elements in hope, believing that this bread and this cup are a pledge and foretaste of the feast of which we shall partake when his kingdom has finally come.
When the creation has been fully redeemed, and all people will come as one before the throne.
And all will humble themselves to declare Jesus, and only Jesus is Lord. We gather in hope that one day all people will be free from the grip of disease, illness, and death. Today we remember the many who are struggling right now due to the current pandemic.
Lord Jesus, hear our prayers. So I invite us as a community of faith to pray together. When you hear the words, Lord Jesus Christ, I invite everyone to respond, have mercy upon us. Let us pray as a community of faith. Lord Jesus Christ,
have
have mercy upon us. For the many people around the world who have died at the hands of this dreadful disease, we pray for them and their loved ones. Lord Jesus Christ, have mercy upon us.
Lord Jesus Christ,
have mercy upon us.
For the frontline workers and essential workers who are striving to help everyone through these difficult times, Lord Jesus Christ,
have mercy upon us.
For the many whose lives have been turned upside down due to this pandemic, those who have lost their jobs, those who are struggling financially, those in the education system, Lord Jesus Christ,
have mercy upon us.
For governments and world leaders, Lord, may they hear your voice of wisdom and reason at this time. Lord Jesus Christ,
have mercy upon us. Lord, for those in our community of faith who are struggling, we raise our personal prayers for them right now. We pray for Muriel and Gary, particularly. Through the struggles that Muriel has been facing now for many months, but particularly these last couple of months, we pray for Gary as he single-handedly takes care of his mother. We pray for Doug Clayton, who fell this week. We pray for Eileen as she takes care of him. In the silence, Lord, we pray for others that we know of. In our community of faith, Lord, hear our prayers. Lord Jesus Christ, have mercy upon us.
Lord Jesus, we gather to remember, without you we are nothing. We remember we need a Savior. We remember our only hope for life is in you. We remember that you are the light of the world, and wherever your light shines, the darkness will not overcome it. Lord Jesus Christ,
have mercy upon us.
Lord, as we take these simple elements of bread and wine, may we remember and rejoice that you are the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in you will live. Come, Lord Jesus, and feed us. Bless us. Fill us with your life. Lord Jesus Christ,
have mercy upon us. On the night that our Lord Jesus was betrayed, he took a simple element of bread. As I, ministering in his name, take this bread today. And he broke it. And he gave it to his disciples, to each of you gathered in your worship spaces. We are a fellowship, a community of faith. So together now, we receive this bread, the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, given to us. I invite you now to partake in the bread. Thanks be to God for the giving of his life to us.
with his friends in that upper room, Jesus took a cup as the conversation continued. He lifted it and said, "This cup is the blood of the new covenant poured out for you. Whenever you do this in remembrance of me. For all those who know deeply, they are loved by Jesus Christ. And we pray that those who do not yet know how deeply they are loved, we share this common cup and proclaim Jesus Christ as Lord." Let us pray. Father God, thank you for this holy mystery that you have given to us, such a rich blessing. Thank you that you've drawn us into the communion that you yourself share between Father, Son, and Spirit. Thank you that you have fed us with your life. As we rise now from our tables, we pray that you would never allow us to forget these truths, but rather imprint them on our hearts, that we may grow and thrive vigorously in faith, a faith committed to being the church, the fellowship that you call us to be. Father, may we at SAS be for you a God-centered, Christ-like, Spirit-filled community church, actively serving and nurturing one another and our neighbors. And may you and you only receive the glory in all that we be and all that we do. Brothers and sisters in Christ, in your worship spaces, rise and go, and may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God, and of God's Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit remain with you always. Amen. God bless you all. We will see you all next Sunday again. God bless.